Hey, everybody. Ham Radio Now, episode 211. The adventures... Oh, wait a minute. This needs echo. This is the kind of thing that needs echo. The adventure of a hacker turned ham. Yeah, much better with echo. Also, some exciting news about the first ham radio on a geostationary satellite. That'll be interesting. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. The hacker turned ham is Michael Ossmann, AD0NR. Pretty shiny new call sign at the point that he gave this talk, 60 days into his ham radio adventure. Michael is the founder of Great Scott Gadgets. He's also the inventor of the HackRF board. HackRF board is an experimental software-defined radio transmitter and receiver board. He launched that, funded it with a Kickstarter. He was asking for $80,000. He raised over $600,000. I think I saw that he raised the goal amount in the first couple of hours. So something everybody wanted. Michael gave a talk about that at the 2013 TAPR DCC. And it is on Ham Radio Now, episode 124. If you missed that somehow, be worth going back to see how he did that. This talk is from the TAPR AMSAT banquet in 2015. It's on a Friday night. It's an outside activity that is, you know, sort of loosely associated with the Dayton Hamvention. So it's Friday of Dayton. It is not a super technical talk because it's the banquet. So, you know, lots of non-hams are there. It is mostly Michael Ossmann's story, which is very compelling. He's an amazing person. It is Michael's take on where the next young hams are going to come from and what ham radio has to offer them. It's going to take a while for him to develop that premise. He'll wind it around his own personal story. It'll be worth listening to. It'll be fun to listen to because Mike is a very good public speaker, in addition to being quite an engineer. Tell you what, here's something that you probably ought to know about TAPR members. They are at, or at least they are interested in, the leading edge of digital technology. Things like packet and digital modes, back in the day when they were getting started. Software-defined radio, digital voice, microwave, mesh networking, things like that. But they are mostly not kids. They may be a little bit younger than average hams, maybe a little bit, but you know, I still see plenty of gray hair. Michael is going to have a quick anecdote about his age that will say a lot about our perspective on what young hams might be. So you'll catch that in there. So that's the theme. It is young hams. Young hams is a common theme today all across ham radio. This time we're going to have a little bit of a new perspective, and it's from a person who has a unique position to have that perspective. But before Michael's talk, the AMSAT faction of the AMSAT TAPR banquet, and they go back and forth sponsoring the and setting up the program in alternate years. The AMSAT faction squeezed in a little last-minute presentation about an upcoming geostationary satellite with a ham radio transponder aboard. The satellite is the Eshalesat 2, and it's owned by the Qatar Satellite Company. It's a project of AMSAT DL Germany and the Qatar Amateur Radio Society. The Qatar hams show up with a booth every year at Dayton, and Jeff and I talked to one of those guys back in 2012. It is part of Ham Radio Now, episode 12C, part 3, which is before I figured out that when you do a show, you make an episode. You do another show, you make another episode. Don't do that. Multiple episodes within one, or multiple shows within one episode. Anyway, that's part of one of our tours, so it's embedded in the tour, if you haven't seen that. But we did see the guys from Qatar, and they pretty enthusiastic group of ham radio operators. The satellite, this Hellsat 2, is scheduled to launch next year, currently thinking end of 2016. The coverage from the satellite is going to be the Middle East, Europe, Africa, into Asia some, including India, but it's going to miss coastal China. There's going to be nothing, unfortunately, in North America or Australia. And we'll catch a little slice of South America, and where Brazil kind of juts out into the Pacific. I can't tell from that map. Maybe a wee bit of Argentina is going to be in there, too. The spectrum that it uses, 2.4 gigahertz uplink, a 10 gigahertz downlink. So no off-the-shelf equipment for working that satellite. Not yet, anyway. The transponders that are going to be on there, 250 kilohertz of linear transponder for, you know, sideband CW, the analog modes, and an 8 megahertz transponder for what they're calling experimental digital modulation schemes and maybe DVB television. So, interesting. A lot of spectrum on that. Most of the satellite is going to be other communication stuff. You know, ham radio is going to have a little bitty piece of that satellite. AMSAT hams know what's exciting about a geostationary satellite. You know, it's 22,000 miles up. It's got super wide coverage. Not North America for this one, sorry. The most important thing is it stays put. Just sits up there in the sky. It's a big permanent band opening that just sits there forever. The closest thing that AMSAT has ever been able to do, and they've been trying, working on geostationary satellites. They've had proposals for a while. The closest thing they've ever come is what they call a highly elliptical orbit, where a satellite will go up, I don't know, not 22,000 miles, but you know, but hundreds of miles? You know, I don't know what I'm talking about. A long way up, and it will appear to be approximately one point in the sky for hours and hours. And then it'll come rushing down. When it goes through the perigee, the low part of the orbit, it'll be pretty close to the planet. It'll zip past, and then we'll head up to another one of those high-hanging apogees. I had to learn apogee and perigee when I took my extra test, so I guess my chance to use the words. Cool. So that's what we've had, and there is no higher or highly elliptical satellite in orbit now. Everything else is the what they call the LEOs, low Earth orbit, and they have a usable window of communication from any point on Earth of 10 to 15 minutes or so. So the highly elliptical gave coverage for hours, and the geosynchronous, geostationary, forever, just stays there operating, but only on one footprint part of the Earth. So it's not going to cover North America, which, you know, it's being put up by the guys in Qatar and Europeans. So obviously that's where they want it to cover. Hopefully this will set sort of a precedent in getting ham radio stuff on other geostationary satellites covering other parts of the world. Once you get it on one of them, you can say, well, they've got it over there. You know, it's not an unheard of concept as we work with the folks that are building these satellites. It won't be one of our satellites. Nothing that hams will build is going to sit up there in a geostationary orbit. At least I don't think so. Fool me. Make me a liar. In addition to setting a good precedent for the future, it will be utilizing bands where we need occupancy. We need to get stuff working up in the gigahertz range. It's not quite so easy to be up there. You know, low loss is pretty much everything. So big feed lines. But it's also not like trying to set terrestrial DX records, eking out the maximum distance from minimum available signal. It's right up there, you know, line of sight. So except for the edges of the footprint, it's not going to require the most awesome microwave and gigahertz station. Something simpler, maybe a lot simpler. So, you know, there go the sunspots. Our sunspot cycle is waning. Maybe this is just in time. And once again, let's see who's going to make some hardware for it. All right. Before we get to the program, I'm going to talk about the Kickstarter for the TAPR Digital Communications Conference. There's where we sit today as I record this. But once again, the fixed deadline is July 31st at 11:59 p.m. And we're a little over third of the way, not quite a third of the way to the $10,000 goal. Now, the Kickstarter needs your support, of course. But typically, individual hams have supplied about half the support for the Kickstarter. And the other half comes from what we call the corporate underwriters. And here, I think I'm going to need your help. What I've got set up for corporate underwriters now is a $500 reward package that gets them a mention, sort of an enhanced mention on the beginning of some of the programs. Now, I've set up the possibility to have 20 corporate underwriters. I doubt if we'll get that many. We probably won't even get 10. So how much time they get in terms of mentions is sort of dependent on how many corporate underwriters we end up with, because we don't want to spend half the show saying thank you to corporate underwriters. So if we get them all, then they'll get a mention on about every fourth show. If we get less, they'll get mentioned more often. And it's more than a mention. It's not like thanks to blah, blah, blah. It is a talk about you just a little bit. I have sent email to every advertiser in QST and CQ, and I did this a week or so ago, telling them about the video for the TAPR conference. And once again, we're supporting the video, not the conference itself. Hold on. What took you so long, Bear? Yes, the bear is back. Oops, wrong camera. There we go. The bear is back, helping me out as co-host, but took him a while to get here and then sink his claws into my into my thigh. So I've sent email to all of the advertisers, every one of them, except for the big four, the big guys, in QST and CQ. And I did it a while ago and have not received any responses or sign-ups on the Kickstarter page from corporate underwriters. We got one from one of the participants, and that's it so far. It could be they're sort of sitting back, seeing what's going to happen, but I don't know. I'll tell you what, though. I am not going to follow up big time with these folks. I'm going to leave that job to you, because getting video of the TAPR conference is something I would like to do very much, but it's something that you guys push for very hard. So, and I've got the right audience this time. It's the TAPR folks. If you know someone at a small company to medium-sized company that does something in ham radio or something that hams would be interested in, parts, components, fabrication, whatever, anything that where they would say, yeah, I want to be a part of the DCC, a part of the video coverage for the DCC, and I want my message to be heard by hams who are interested in this sort of thing, then make the contact, point it out. You know these folks, you know them better than I do. So it would help to have that kind of contact made. I'm not going to promise any return on investment from these guys. If they spend $500 getting their name out there, and I mention it, they may not ever hear from any of you. That's kind of also up to you. Or they might. They might get $500 worth, they might get $5,000 worth, and they might not quite make it. So, I can't make any promises like that, and no refunds. But if you can help out, we got till July 31st. If that doesn't work, if we don't reach our goal, $10,000 goal, alas, I won't be able to go to Chicago and shoot this thing. I can't do it on standard Ham Radio Now contributions. They have proven to be inadequate to the task. It's expensive to get there and shoot this stuff, but mostly it's expensive to get it all edited and put online. That's a good, solid, full-time month or more of my labor. So takes a while. Okay, so that's the deal for the Kickstarter. Once again, stop by the hamradionow.tv website. There we go. And right up there near the top is the button that will take you to the Kickstarter. And there's a video to play for anybody who's not too familiar with it, and the opportunity to back the project, either as individuals or as a corporate underwriter. So that's the Kickstarter. And now, back to Dayton. Coming up in a moment, Michael Ossmann, who is now AD0NR. But first, it is AMSAT President Barry Baines, WD4ASW. He is going to introduce Thani al-Malki from the Qatar Satellite Company. And they will talk about SHALSAT 2 and ham radio, and a little video of the one they've got up there already, SHALSAT 1, which was launched a couple years ago. So back to Dayton.
I'd like to welcome you here this evening. A great turnout, a great crowd. We appreciate the support you've extended to both TAPR and AMSAT. As you well know, we have a primary speaker this evening, but we've been blessed, if you will, with a special presentation we're going to provide with you at this point. Many of you, particularly in the AMSAT community, are aware that there's some development work being done to fly a geostationary amateur payload to be flown over the Mideast. We are indeed fortunate that we have one of our guests here this evening is from Qatar. He's a sales engineer with the company that's building that satellite. And his name is Thani Ali al-Malki from Qatar. And we've asked him if he would take a few minutes to explain to us the project, the amateur radio payload that's being flown into geostationary orbit. So without much further ado, I'd like to bring Thani on board and have him give his presentation.
First of all, thank you for giving us the time to present the material we have. I'll start with a really short video about my company and our first satellite that we launched end of 2013.
بالنظرة الثاقبة لسمو الأمير الوالد جاء مشروع سهيل وبرئاسة سمو الأمير الشيخ تميم بن حمد آل ثاني حفظه الله تمت بداية المشروع. سهيل سوف يساعد قطر على البث التلفزيوني والاتصالات الفضائية باستقلالية وبنوعية مميزة وبتغطية جغرافية واسعة. سهيل سوف يدعم رؤية قطر 2030. كذلك إسهيل سوف يقوم ببناء بنية تحتية آمنة لقطر ولتلبية احتياجات فيفا 2022.
القمر الصناعي إسهيل واحد كما هو معروف هو أول قمر صناعي لدولة قطر. تم بناء هذا القمر الصناعي إلى أحدث التكنولوجيا المتوافرة في قطاع الأقمار الصناعية، يعمل على زيادة القدرة على عدم الاختراق أو عدم التشويش، يساعد المشغلين القطريين أو المشغلين المحليين والمشغلين في منطقة الشرق الأوسط وشمال أفريقيا على تحقيق مبدأ الاستغلالية وتوفير خدمة نظيفة ومستمرة وبدون انقطاع. يساعد القمر سهيل واحد على توفير ساعات قمرية إضافية محتاج لها السوق حاليا في هذه المنطقة. الهدف كذلك السعي إلى سهيل اثنين وسهيل ثلاثة وسهيل أربعة ليس فقط سهيل واحد.
سهيل تطور مذهل لقطرنا الحبيبة التي تستحق دائما منا الأفضل.
So you've seen part of Qatar, my company, our CEO, the minister also. It's all about the first satellite operator in Qatar. So we launched our first satellite. It was successful, nearly almost full with the capacity up and running. So now we're building our second satellite. So I'll be talking about just a quick overview about the second satellite, then the AMSAT requirement, the frequency band selection, and the technical solution. So about SAIL 2, it's our second satellite. It's going to be operational end of 2016, owned by Qatar, and currently manufactured by Melco in Japan. And hopefully it's going to be launched in 2016. So it's going to have 24 Ku band transponders, Ka band transponder as well, and most interesting to you is the two AMSAT transponders covering visible Earth. So the high-level requirement. We wanted to have a payload that could connect 100 users with a dish smaller than 1 meter with a 10-watt buck. So also the onboard receiver shall have a sensitivity less than minus 117 dBm. And they have an experimental payload, which is a video transmission. So one-way communication will be 2.7 kilohertz. 100 users will be 50 channels. So it's going to be around 250 kilohertz. And the second transponder should, you know, send a video, like 2 to 3 signals. So now I'm going to show you the footprint, which could cover part of South America with Far East. Unfortunately, the US is not covered.
No.
However, maybe with that second satellite, we can connect, you know, users from the US, hopefully. So the payload, one more time, we can connect, you know, 90 channels, maybe 180 users, and we have a video transmission, which is just experimental, 2 to 3 video channels. So now to go to the frequency, why we chose the specific frequency we have. We had the choice either to go with a L-band uplink and S-band downlink, or S-band uplink and X-band downlink. So we have some pros and cons between two selections. So the LS band, you know, the equipment is widely available. However, the interference with the Wi-Fi and ISM is there's a risk of an interference. The S and X band, it's easier to have it on a CSAT because it has a lower mass and takes lower space. And we can share it with the Ku band frequencies we have. The cons is only that the equipment is less spread, but however, it is available. So we chose S and X band. These are the frequencies. And now to go to the technical solution. So there is a narrow band and the wide band. The narrow band inside the receiver, there is a double conversion. And you could see below the narrow band, the specific frequencies we have, and the wide band, which is for the video, the specific frequencies. The transponder bandwidth for the ham is like 250 kilohertz. The video is a bit higher, which is 8 megahertz. So now to go with the edge of coverage, we have a G over T of minus 12 on the edge of the of the footprint. And the ERP is around 31 dBW. The NB transponder has an AGC function with an attack time of 50 milliseconds and the decay time of 2 seconds. And those are the coverage for the narrow beam and what you think. This is the downlink and this is the uplink, sorry. So now to go to the plug diagram. This is, of course, AMSAT Germany helped us with those block diagram because they've done it, and we are expert only on the satellite and the communication. So they gave us this design, and we did a link budget to see how small dish sizes we can go. So in the rainy places like Brazil, we can go with like maybe a higher dish size, which is around 89 centimeters. The rest of areas, maybe 60 centimeters, and elsewhere 75 with a 10-watt buck. And the most important thing here is the availability. It's going to be 95%. so which is quite amazing. So that's about it. Thank you very much for your time. I don't want to take more of your time. Everyone's like...
And where can people learn to get more information?
You can find us in booth 415. We're here tomorrow like 9 to 6. And we're all welcome to come and ask questions. And if you have anything else, we could really help you. And thank you for having us today.
Thank you, Thani. As you heard, this project is really being conducted in conjunction with AMSAT DL, with AMSAT Germany. And they're the ones that have provided the technical assistance to the folks in Qatar to make this possible from an amateur radio perspective. We thought you would find this very interesting. It behooves us to understand what's happening in the rest of the world. It will not touch the United States, but a lot of our European friends are excited about this, and we want to make sure you were aware of the developments that are occurring under those organizational leadership challenges. So with that, I'm going to turn the mic over to Steve. He's going to introduce our primary speaker this evening and make some other comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Barry.
Okay, good evening, everyone. So we'd like to segue into the banquet speakers part of it. So I see everybody's pretty much finished up with their dessert and they've got their chairs turned around, so that's a good sign. So I want to welcome everybody, and my name is Stephen Bible, N7HPR. I'm the president of TAPR, and it's our honor as each year for the TAPR / AMSAT banquet. This year TAPR then selects and invites a banquet speaker. So that was our opportunity this year. And of course, next year it'll be the AMSAT TAPR banquet, at which time AMSAT will select a banquet speaker. So as you can see, the title kind of shifts around every other year. So this is a lot of fun, being able to provide, you know, this respite at a long, arduous day of spending money. Yeah, there's a lot of walking, and you notice it's not really helping with that girth, but I encourage you to keep walking, yes. We really want to see a lot of that excess weight disappear. So let me start off by offering everyone here in this room a thought exercise. And the thought exercise that I put together and I've used a number of times is to ask you, at what age did you become a ham, and what was it about ham radio that excited you at that time? So we got any volunteers to raise their hand and tell us what age and what excited them? Bruce?
So I was 15 and there was no internet. So that was the internet for me.
Okay, so Bruce was 15. It's hard to imagine, but we all were young once, and then the ham radio provided that, the communications that the internet offers today. Anybody else? So we got 15. Bob?
I've often wondered what is the appeal of amateur radio besides tinkering? I was 14. I concluded it was action at a distance.
Okay, so for Bob is age 14 and he says action at a distance, which, somehow that springs this idea of using this position reporting or packet reporting. Okay, so let me ask, how many at age 12? Okay, how many at age 13?
You did it the wrong way.
I should go down?
Yeah, 10 years old.
Okay, well, I offered for you to raise your hand, Bob. And
I did twice.
Okay, here's Bob. Bob's not one to be shy. All right, 14, 15, 16, 17. Okay, and there's a reason for that. Oh, look at this. He had puberty late in life. All right, so we'll kind of stop there because we all know what happens. We go through our crazy time, you know, when we hit the 14, 15, 16. And then what happens is then life intervenes around the 20s. But when I've been doing this thought exercise, what's been really fascinating to me is to find, and I would consider everyone in this room a lifelong ham, right? And I've noticed something. Lifelong hams tend to have gotten into the hobby when they were 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So there's probably no coincidence there. So for those people that could be interested in said hobby at that age will probably more than likely become a lifelong purveyor of that hobby. Case in point, here's ham radio. Now, the other half of that question is what excited you about ham radio is also very important. And I want you to kind of keep that in your mind because the thought experiment goes further. After you've gone around the room and you've learned at what age and what really excited them, here's how I kind of turn the experiment around, is say, okay, then what would it take to excite a 14-year-old today? Boy, that raised a grumble, didn't it?
Make that 12.
Okay, well, 12, yeah. So, and what I just chose 14 because it's in the middle, but 10, 11, 12 to 16, 12 to 15. What would it take today to excite a 12 to 16-year-old today in ham radio? And it's not your grandfather's ham radio, folks. That's not the answer. All right, it's got to be that thing that excites them today, and that is what ham radio arguably needs to be today. All right, so that's the thought. It's not for debate, David. Well, no, we got to, this is not about me. This is about us, and this is about ham radio, because I'd like to introduce Michael Ossmann. So, Michael, to how many of you pledge and fund and are a patron of Kickstarter projects?
No, they're called suckers, not patrons.
I'll tell you what, and Bruce will raise his hand. There's some really cool, neat projects up there. And it next to Amazon, that's my other store. Okay, because I can't find anything more unusual, unique that's on Kickstarter.
But Steve, Amazon gives it to you in 2 days.
there's definitely some compare and contrast there. All right, again, this is not about me. I want to introduce Michael here, and I'm taking a very long time in doing that. So Michael is dabbling in listening to radio waves and figuring out what's going on there. And so then he first came out with a Bluetooth sniffer. And then he offered that up on Kickstarter, and it was successful. And then, not to be deterred by success, he offers up another project that he created called Hack RF, and that's for sale today. And it was another successful. So I sent off an email to Michael, and I said, Michael, would you please come to DCC? And so he came to the DCC in Seattle. So that was last year we were in Austin, the year before we were in Seattle. Because I wanted him to see how crazy and unusual we are. So that's his talk today. So he actually got his ham radio license, so AD0NR. So let's listen to what Michael has to say about us. And this great hobby that we call amateur radio. So welcome, Michael Ossmann.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, everybody, for having me. When I was asked to do this, I was terrified because I know you're friendly, but It is something, I do a lot of speaking actually at events around the world, mostly hacker cons, and I don't often follow someone who's as distinguished as Dr. Tom Clark, K3IO. He gave such a good talk last year, and I was there. I can prove it because my nose is in the video. It's actually featured several times in the video. So whoever is just right at the edge of the screen here, watch out.
Wait a minute. Let's get you on the screen.
There I am. Thank you. Thank you.
Photoshop.
It's So I don't have credentials like K3IO. He's been a ham for 60 years, and I've been a ham for 60 days. Exactly, 60 days. And I was really terrified at first because I thought, what do I have to offer this group? And it was made clear to me that what I do have to offer is a completely different perspective, and maybe some things that you hadn't thought of before, views on the culture that I'm a part of, the hacker community, and the culture that I'm becoming a part of, the ham community, and how those things will relate in the future. So, to give you an idea of where I'm coming from, this was my first electronics kit. I found this photo online, but I'm pretty sure it's the exact model that my brother and I had. And I imagine that many of you had similar kits or gave similar kits or have played with them, seen them. They're wonderful little things. When I was a kid, maybe, I don't know, 8 years old, 7 years old, something like that. I think my older brother had one of these, and I started playing with it pretty early, maybe even 6 years old, I don't know. But I used to love playing with this thing. And I would make all sorts of different circuits that were in a little book that told me how to make circuits. And I started fiddling with electronics and really getting excited about electronics. And actually, if you asked me what I wanted to be when I grew up, when I was in grade school, I think I told people I wanted to be an electrical engineer. And I will never forget how I used to strip wires with my teeth. Yeah. And I bet some of you can relate to this. The reason I'll never forget it is because of the notch in my front tooth. Uh-huh. Yeah. So I did have an uncle who was a ham, and he was kind of a cantankerous, old, cigarette-smoking, retired firefighter. You know the type. And he was somebody who I didn't get to see very often. We didn't live very close to him, and I think he was my oldest uncle. So he didn't rub off on me a whole lot, but it's because of him that I even knew that amateur radio was a thing. And in these days when I was playing with electronics, I didn't get very far. I could build things based on someone else's instructions, but I couldn't really design a circuit myself. I don't think I ever built anything without instruction other than like a couple batteries and a light bulb. Or, ooh, this is crazy, a couple batteries and a DC motor. Yeah, really exciting stuff, right? But nobody was, I didn't have a mentor. I didn't have anyone helping me learn this stuff. I was just kind of learning it on my own and playing around. And, you know, I did see the ham shack that my uncle had, and I thought that was kind of interesting, but I didn't really get it. But my uncle was an operator. And in this talk, when I say operator, I mean an amateur radio operator whose identity as an amateur radio operator is as an operator, as a user of the amateur bands to communicate, as opposed to an experimenter, somebody whose identity as an amateur radio operator is tinkering with electronics, experimenting with new circuits, experimenting with new modes of communication. And to me, these are two very different images that I have of amateur radio operators. I have images of operators and I have images of experimenters. My uncle was an experimenter. I'm sorry. Thank you for correcting me. My uncle was an operator. And but I didn't get to talk to him too much about what he did. And I'd never had anyone kind of guide me through my interest in electronics. And I didn't get very far because a funny thing happened. My grade school got one of these Apple IIe's when they first came out. Just one for the whole school. And I think I spent more time on that computer than the rest of the school combined. But I was very fortunate that I was able to do that, that I was able to pursue this interest. And I was just completely hooked as soon as I started playing with these things. And not just the Apple II, but other computers as well. Whatever I could get my hands on, really. And eventually when we got an Apple II at my house, a year or two later, I would use that computer at night. I would sneak up in the middle of the night and use that computer. I would use it on weekends. I would use it after school. I would use it when I was supposed to be in school. And I had friends who were getting computers too. I remember my friend Scott had a TI computer and my friend Marco had a Commodore 64. And I was playing with all these different computers that different people had and this wonderful kind of explosion of this personal computer revolution there. And the thing that all these different computers had in common was BASIC. And you could sit down at any computer and start typing out a BASIC program and type run and see it work. And this was just an incredible thing for me. And that's what I loved to do, was to program these things. And I was very fortunate. I was very fortunate that I had a good friend, Elizabeth Dorman, whose father, Mark Dorman, volunteered his time to come to my school and teach us kids who were interested how to program in BASIC. And he was he worked at the county offices in their data processing center, what we would today call IT. And he took time out, I don't know, one or two days a week to come and just take maybe five or six of us kids at the school who were interested in this computer and teach us how to program. So thank you, Mark Dorman. But what it taught me and my experience with computers and what excited me about computers at the time is that computers are for programming. Now, you can use computers for a lot of different things. But to me, what's special about a computer is that you can program it. You can make it do whatever you want it to do. Computers are for programming. Now, we used to save all our programs on floppy disks, mostly these 5 1/4-inch disks or later 3 1/2-inch disks. My friends and I would write programs and share them with one another. I remember in particular my friend Eric Martella. He and I don't remember which of us started this, but at some point we discovered a way that we could create a program that would hide itself. Like if you tried to list the program, if you tried to view the instructions, in the view the actual program itself, the process of viewing it would erase it or delete or hide it in some way. And I don't even remember what the mechanism was. All I remember was that we then had an arms race where one of us, it was a game, one of us would come up with some sort of a protection scheme where we would have a program that would be difficult to analyze. And then the other one, and we'd hand, I'd come up with something and I'd hand him a floppy disk. Well, a week later, he would hand me a floppy disk because he would have figured out my scheme and come up with something better. And I would have to figure that out. And then I would hand him a floppy disk. And we went back and forth, I don't know how many times. But I think that was the first time I really developed an interest in computer security, something that stuck with me through my whole life as I've worked with computers. Now, in addition to sharing programs that we wrote, we sometimes shared programs other people wrote. I found fascinating some of the means that were used for copy protection of these floppy disks. And actually, in hindsight, I think they might even be more fascinating than they were to me at the time. At the time, they were a barrier to overcome. But now I find them just really interesting, and I recommend looking sometime. Look up, there are some interesting articles online about how copy protection on floppy disks was implemented. Primarily, it was implemented by taking advantage of some feature of the hardware that was writing the floppy disk or mastering the floppy disk at the factory. That was a feature that was difficult or impossible to implement on a home floppy disk. And so you could have, for example, you could have like a place, a location on the disk where if you read it with your home floppy drive, it would sometimes read one value and sometimes read another value. And so then you'd have a program that would like read that value over and over and over again, read that location, and if it saw a varying value over time, it would say, oh, okay, that's a legit disk, because it's really hard to do that, to create a disk that would be wrong in that way with your consumer equipment. So, you know, there was stuff like that, and there were tricks to overcome those copy protections, like finding a way to get your home floppy drive to emulate what the factory floppy drive did. That's one way you could overcome it. Or another way you could overcome it would be by patching the program and removing the check for that particular feature of the floppy disk. So there were multiple, and then that's just one example of one kind of way that these floppy disks were protected from copying. There were many, many different schemes, and each one was defeatable. But finding out how to defeat them was a challenge, a technical challenge. And copying these disks was very rewarding. It was something fun for us kids to do. We didn't really think at the time anything of it in terms of like, should we be doing it or not. It was just a fun challenge, and it was a fun way to get software that there's no way we would have gotten otherwise. We were middle class community. None of us kids had any money to buy software, but we could trade software. We could share software, and we shared both software that we wrote ourselves, and we also shared software that other people wrote. Now, at one point, it's been a long time now, but I still don't think I should name this teacher. I did in the seventh grade, I think. Have a teacher who gave me an A in exchange for cracking the copy protection on some software. And I was very glad of that at the time, because otherwise I would have failed that class. Because I wasn't very good at school. In fact, the following year, I completely dropped out. But at the time, it was cool for me. I liked the fact that I was able to help my teacher in that way, and I was able to get out something out of it, and my teacher was able to get something out of it, and the school was able to get something out of it, because the software that I was cracking was actually something that was being used for a school project, and they just wanted to be able to use more computers, use that software on more computers than just, you know, the three that they had floppy disks for, or something like that. So it seemed like a win-win at the time. Now, my parents never allowed a modem in the house, which was probably a good move on their part. And so everything that I learned, and every piece of software that I had, and all my contact with the outside world was completely through sharing of floppy disks. And it was amazing how much I was able to learn through sharing a floppy disk, and how much all of us kids were able to communicate with each other just by sharing floppy disks. Now, of course, I'm sharing floppy disks with a friend who has another friend who has a modem, and, you know, so we had communications distantly through people, and so we kind of knew what was going on in the world of young hackers, but I wasn't a very active participant, other than my own projects and my own computer and my own small circle of friends. But it instilled in me, I think, a very strong motivation, a very strong value, that sharing is good. And I'm sure some of you have heard of Linux. I'll explain it to you later, Bruce. That's really good. Oh, I have a slide for this. So, over time, I completely forgot about electronics. The only thing that reminded me that I used to kind of like to tinker with electronics is that groove in my tooth. And I always thought it was kind of cool that these great computers were built from electronics. But my interest was computers. And I also gained other interests. In college, I was actually a music major. But the way I paid my way through school was by working in the computer labs, because I was good with computers. And that's where I started getting introduced to Unix systems. And after school, I ended up doing a lot of system administration work. Really, I was an IT system administrator and network administrator for many years, and I was doing mostly Unix systems, HPUX, Solaris, AIX, all kinds of different Unix systems. And as I learned those things, it became very apparent to me that one of the reasons that those systems were so powerful was because they shared. A lot of the commonalities between those different systems were BSD licensed software. And other software that was shared in other ways. And I, at some point in the mid-90s, became a Linux user, and I have been ever since. I've been running Linux on laptops ever since I've had laptops. And it's what I use as my primary system. And throughout my career as a system administrator and network administrator, I was working on infrastructure. I was working on web servers and other types of servers, DNS servers, mail servers, mostly internet-connected infrastructure that was all Unix-based, and it was all running open-source software. Even in kind of the early days when not everyone really knew what open-source was, open-source was running the internet. And I was able to take advantage of that, and everything that I did as a system administrator, I was able to take advantage of the open source software that was out there to be able to do more and better things and more interesting things in my career. And in hindsight, every single thing that I can think of in my career that I'm proud of is something that I accomplished with the help of open source software. Without exception, every single thing I ever did that I'm proud of. And that has really caused me to be an extreme proponent of open source. One of my friends calls me an ultra-orthodox open source aficionado or something like that. Not just open source software, but also open source hardware these days. So I also became more and more, over the years, more and more involved in the hacker community. Originally, when I was a kid, I was kind of insulated. But as I grew up and as I got to know the internet, as an adult was working with internet infrastructure, I was communicating with people all over the world, and I came to realize that I was a hacker. I never really thought of myself in that way or called myself that until maybe in the 90s, maybe even the late 90s, when I would kind of say, yeah, I'm a hacker, because that's the culture that I'm a part of. Hackers are people who share. They share their code, they share their techniques, sharing is just such an important part of the culture. Hackers program. Computers are for programming. And this may seem like a funny value to have, that programming is an ethic, but it really is for hackers, because computers, general purpose computers, are so powerful. There's nothing else in the world like a Turing machine. Mm-hmm. And being able to control that is something to cherish. And if you have a computer, you should be able to program it, and you should program it. Hackers respect achievement. They don't necessarily respect credentials, but they respect you for what you've accomplished. Hackers love to learn. Hackers are curious. Perhaps that's the most defining characteristic of a hacker, is curiosity. And I've always been somebody who loves to learn. In those days when I did actually drop out of school, what I was doing was hiding out in my house and reading books and playing the piano and working on computer programs and playing video games. But much of the time I was just fascinated by things and trying to learn. I left school so that I could learn more. I did eventually go back to school, but that was truly one of my motivations. Hackers question authority. That doesn't mean they disrespect authority, although in certain cases that may be warranted. They question authority. They don't just assume that authority is correct. They want it to be demonstrated. They want it to be proven. Show me why this authority is correct. And hackers want to make the world a better place. And this is probably universally true of everyone that I know who calls themselves a hacker. They're all people who are, one way or another, trying to find ways to fix things, make things better, make things more interesting, make things more neighborly, however a particular hacker puts it. So fast forward a few years. As I got more and more into infrastructure, internet infrastructure, I got more into security, and eventually I got into Wi-Fi security, and then somehow somebody who read an article that I wrote about Wi-Fi security decided that they should give me a job doing wireless security research. And I started actually doing research on APCO P25 radios. I know some of you are thinking, wow, finally this guy's talking about something interesting. So I started to learn a lot about public safety communication systems. I learned a little bit about amateur radio. Mostly I was very focused on the technology, and I was looking at over-the-air attacks on P25 systems. Are they vulnerable? Could they be vulnerable to over-the-air attacks against the digital attacks that are executed over the air? And I found that, yes, they most certainly are vulnerable. And I could point to people, I could point to places in the standards and say, like, oh, here on page 482, if somebody sends this control message that's completely unauthenticated, your radio will shut down, or you know, something bad will happen. And people would say, oh, that's great, kid. You know, no one's ever going to do that. It's too hard. And then I discovered software-defined radio. And what I mean by discovered is somebody handed me software-defined radio equipment and said, hey, Mike, see what you can do with this. And I started focusing on the problem of taking the theoretical attacks, the things that I came up with by looking at the specification, and actually implementing them using software-defined radio. And so then, eventually, I mean, it took me more than a year, but eventually I got to the point where I could demonstrate to somebody, here's what happens when somebody sends this unauthenticated control message and your entire system goes belly up. And then people started paying a little bit more attention to the work I was doing, and I started actually having somewhat of an impact. It was extremely rewarding for me as a hacker and as somebody who wants to make the world a better place. It was rewarding for me to be able to actually show people something, practical attacks instead of just theoretical attacks, particularly when they actually got people's attention who might be able to help fix things. I want to say thanks to Robert Stafford, because when I was at the Boulder Labs in Colorado working on this stuff, Dr. Rob Stafford was the person who, more than anyone else, really helped me, really mentored me. I wouldn't have been able to learn that much about SDR in a year if I weren't in a very fortuitous situation. I was the one computer guy amongst 100 RF engineers, and they needed help with things like installing Linux. And I could help them with that. And while I was helping them with that, they would teach me things that I wanted to learn, like RF, electronics, like DSP. And digital signal processing is the thing that Rob Stafford helped me with the most. There were many, many days, many nights, I should say, when he and I were the last two in the office, and I would wander down the hall, and he'd be there, and I'd ask him some question, and he'd go to the whiteboard, and we'd be there for an hour. So thank you, Rob. And during this time, or shortly following this time, when I was at the labs but had acquired some SDR knowledge, I started using that knowledge and using some of the techniques that I was that I had developed at work to do some projects for fun. And one of the things that inspired me as I was getting more involved in the hacker community was Bluetooth. Wi-Fi, for example, is a communications technology that has been very, it's had quite a history in the security community. When it first came out, it was broken, and then it was fixed, and then it was broken again, and then it was fixed, and it was broken again, and it kept going through these cycles where people would hack on it and figure out weaknesses, and then it would get better. And this happened relatively quickly because people had tools. The hackers had tools that they were able to use to monitor Wi-Fi traffic and to inject Wi-Fi traffic or transmit arbitrary data. Well, the same kind of tools didn't exist for Bluetooth. You couldn't even locate or detect that a Bluetooth device existed unless you had prior knowledge of its address. And that just seemed really silly. So I started looking at how to use software-defined radio to solve this problem. And I found a couple people who had gone before me, and I picked up their work and started continuing it. And it's something, and one of those people is Dominic Spill, who works for me now. And we continue to work on Bluetooth stuff together. One of the reasons Bluetooth sniffing is hard is because it's a frequency hopping system. And so it's hard to predict what frequency a particular device will be on at a given time. Another reason Bluetooth sniffing is hard, Bluetooth monitoring is hard, is because the part of the packet that you expect to be able to recognize at the beginning of the packet is device specific. It's specific to the address, the device you're looking for. So you need to have prior knowledge to know what to look for. And another reason is the packets are whitened or scrambled by XORing the data with a pseudo-random sequence. So you have to have some kind of knowledge of the state of that pseudo-random generator in order to make sense of the data. And so all these problems make it such that a Bluetooth adapter must be specifically engineered for passive monitoring. These problems are more difficult, more expensive to solve than implementing a regular Bluetooth adapter. So regular Bluetooth adapters don't do it, as opposed to Wi-Fi, where Wi-Fi adapters are constantly receiving packets that they aren't interested in, and they recognize them as valid Wi-Fi packets, and then they look at them and say, "Oh, that one's not for me," and they just discard it. They're constantly monitoring whether they want to or not. Bluetooth devices are completely different. So I wanted to make a Bluetooth sniffer, and I wanted to make it open source because I'm dedicated to open source, and I think everything should be open source. And I wanted it to be widely available and portable and around $100. And I thought that I could do something like this, like rip the RF front end out of one piece of hardware and tack it on to analog digital converter from another piece of hardware and connect that to a PC and then use our software that we had already developed for software-defined radio in order to make this low-cost Bluetooth sniffer that anyone could build. So it was a software-defined radio architecture, that is, radio by digital signal processing. And this is what I had been doing for the last couple of years before this project. So I was looking at different equipment and trying to rip out 2.4 gigahertz RF front ends out of things, and it's turned out to be kind of hard. And I started thinking, well, maybe I'm going to have to roll my own RF front end somehow. And then I started looking at ADCs and like TV tuner cards and stuff. And and I started thinking, well, maybe I might have to kind of roll my own back end too. And this was a little bit terrifying. So, you know, you all know Ohm's law, right? It's a really important thing to know if you're working with electronics. And it really nicely sums up absolutely everything I knew about electronics at the time. I had never programmed a microcontroller. I had never done any surface mount soldering. I had never designed a circuit more complicated than a DC motor. So this was a challenging project to take on, but I was able to take it on because I was learning from people around me. And I was very lucky to have people around me who could help me with this project. You know, I can learn. The ideal solution I came up with was a microcontroller that would be USB connected and have a built-in analog to digital converter, but that actually kind of turned out to be hard to find for my particular application. And then my ideal front-end integrated circuit would be maybe a WiMAX chip, potentially. And it turned out that these were kind of hard to find, or there were some chips coming out that hadn't been released yet that looked like they might be ideal, but how do I convince the manufacturer to give me data sheets or give me sample chips for something that isn't really published yet, or maybe never will be in the public? So I kind of created this fake company and put up a website and registered a domain name and drew this logo. And I created, I just thought up this name, Great Scott Gadgets, and I started emailing people from this domain, people at different manufacturers, trying to get them to give me data sheets and give me sample chips and so forth. And this totally did not work. not at all. Well, I think I got one data sheet out of one manufacturer, and that was it. But what if it had worked? What if I had actually managed to convince some integrated circuit vendor to give me parts and give me information on how to use them? They probably would have made me sign an NDA to do it. And then where would that have gotten me? I was trying to create an open source product, a project that anyone could then build and understand and modify and use. And if I had actually pursued this more fully and succeeded in getting some parts under NDA, it really would have undermined my entire quest. So I realized eventually that I had requirements just for the parts to use in the project. The parts needed to be available in single quantity and have public documentation that was accessible without signing a non-disclosure agreement. And meanwhile, I was working on some microcontroller projects. I thought it would be a good idea to actually learn how to use a microcontroller since I wanted to put one on my project. And so I started doing things like playing with the IME. And this was introduced to me by Travis Goodspeed at a conference where we were snowed in once. And I wrote this firmware for it after he showed me how to program it. I wrote firmware for it that turns it into a spectrum analyzer. And you know, this is a pink toy that's for text messaging over 900 megahertz. And but it turns out that it has a very easily programmable microcontroller in it, and you can get it to do whatever you want. And it has a cool little radio in it, all in one chip. So, you know, computers are for programming, and this has a computer in it, so, you know, let's program it. And I also started building my own very simple, small microcontroller circuits and programming those as well. The CC2400 is a chip that is similar to the chip. It's in the same family as the chip that's in the IME. And so thanks to my work on the IME, I was able to find this part and figure out that it belonged in my Bluetooth sniffer. The architecture that I ended up with is using that chip, the CC2400, because it had this particular mode in which it would demodulate and stream the bits transmitted by any Bluetooth device constantly without any regard for the format of the packet or anything like that. And I could just plug it into a microcontroller and stuff those bits over USB. It was kind of like having an SDR, except my demodulator was actually in silicon on the wireless transceiver chip. So I abandoned the SDR architecture, but I still had a flexible software on the host computer that's dealing with a stream of bits, which may or may not be packets. And I did most of this work in days leading up to conferences where I was talking about this work. I'm sure you've all had similar experiences. And I came up with Ubertooth 1, which was the final version of this project. That is actually still being sold today. And it is just a USB dongle that is a special purpose device for nothing other than Bluetooth monitoring. It can be used for other things, but the reason it was designed was just to capture Bluetooth packets without having to have any prior knowledge of the devices being monitored. And that's the killer app for Ubertooth, and that's why it's still popular today. In fact, popularity seems to be increasing today for just one purpose, and that is discovering Bluetooth devices that are in non-discoverable mode. That's it. That's all this thing. That's not all it does, but that's the main thing that people want it for, is to discover Bluetooth devices that are in non-discoverable mode. Yay, surface mount technology. Don't you love it? I do. It's small, which means it's portable. It's cheap, low-cost stuff. And fast, and not just fast to work with, but fast in terms of signals, right? You can get gigahertz signals going through these things. Amazing. And you know, we're in the surface mount generation. It is a surface mount world out there. And it's wonderful technology to work with once you actually get used to it. And so when I started the Ubertooth project, I really started trying to encourage more people to to get into building these things and build your own Ubertooth or build your own any kind of device using surface mount technology. You can order PCBs at a very low cost, and then you can order a stencil also at a pretty low cost. And solder, you put the solder paste onto the PCB and place the components with some fine tip tweezers and go cross-eyed a little bit, and everything starts to look really big. And then you just put it on a hot plate and heat it up, and all the solder melts at once. And you should get one of these infrared thermometers. You don't really need one, they're just fun to play with. And you end up with a finished product that, you know, in many cases looks like it's professionally made and can totally be done at home on your own workbench. It's something that, it's a leap that people have to make to say, oh, I'm going to build a project with 0402 surface mount components and QFNs and BGAs and so forth. I was even scared of BGAs after working on Ubertooth, but then I started working on them. They're not that hard to do hot plate reflow with. And you can buy even a pretty decent hot air rework station for $100 these days. It's not that hard to get into. It's something that I think everybody should get into if you're into electronics. I want to thank Jared Boone, because I couldn't have done this project without him. I was learning, I had the opportunity at the Boulder Labs to learn from people who had a lot of theoretical knowledge and a lot of older knowledge about electronics. But Jared was somebody who helped me with modern knowledge of electronics and how to work with the currently available components and actually practically build something like this in this size. So people started asking when can I buy one? When will I have them in shops? And I was like, I have this company. it was a fake company, but it became real very quickly because there was interest from folks in the hacker community to buy an Ubertooth so that they could start doing things like Bluetooth security assessments, which in some cases they were already doing, but just didn't have good tools to do it with. And so I used Kickstarter, and as Steve mentioned, it was a successful project, and it was so successful that about 3 months after I started shipping Ubertooth, I actually had the ability to quit my day job and just start working on Gray Scott Gadgets full time. So one of the things that I wanted to do when I started doing that was to look back at the Ubertooth project and think, what could I have done if I'd gone down a different path? I was originally thinking it would be some sort of a small SDR platform, and that could be much more flexible and much more powerful and do things other than just finding undiscoverable Bluetooth devices. And so I thought, here I'm traveling around to conferences and stuff and going to jobs and so forth, and with a bag full of all these different special purpose devices. I've got, okay, so my device for Bluetooth is pretty small, but it just does Bluetooth. And I have a whole bunch of different hardware platforms for different types of technologies. And trying to have a different device for every single different technology that I was interested in led me to a situation where my wallet looked like this, and my backpack looks like this. Some of you have seen this joke already. My backpack looked like this, and my girlfriend looked like this. So one of the reasons that I took on the project of HackRF was because I wanted the device myself. I wanted a low-cost, portable, very flexible radio transceiver that I could use to hack on just about anything. But another reason, and perhaps the more important reason, is that I felt that the world needs open source hardware for SDR. We already had open source software for SDR, and there's a growing body of open source software for SDR. But HackRF was the first significant open source hardware for SDR. And I feel that it's very important that people have a reference platform that can be modified, that can be used for any purpose. If you're doing academic research in software-defined radio, how great is it to have a platform that you can start from and then potentially modify, and other people would be able to reproduce that work. I think that's extremely important. So I set out to build HackRF, and you know, thanks to everything that I learned from all the people around me, I was able to produce HackRF 1, which is in production today. This is a device that's a wireless transceiver from 1 megahertz to 6 gigahertz. And actually, just today, I officially made it 1 megahertz instead of 10, but 1 megahertz to 6 gigahertz. And it allows you to transmit or receive, when it's hooked up to a host computer, virtually any radio signal. So it allows people to experiment with technologies that they've never been able to experiment with before. And this is just a kind of a glamour shot of the PCB, because it's one of the more difficult layout jobs I've ever done, so I like to show it off. I'd like to take a little diversion here. Some of you probably know this little oddball thing about Microsoft Outlook, but it's something that plagued me for years. It started, I don't know when, more than 10 years ago. But Microsoft Outlook implemented this feature that when people were typing in their emails, if they would type a smiley, like colon, close parentheses, or maybe colon minus close parentheses, or maybe both, it would auto-correct that and turn it into a little graphical character of a smiley face. And that character was implemented in the Wingdings font, which was a Microsoft font, and then inserted in the email and sent to the recipient. And if the recipient had a Microsoft computer, you know, with Microsoft Outlook, it would find that character and render it with the Wingdings font and see the smiley face. But for anyone else, including anyone who uses Linux, who didn't have the Wingdings font, they would, instead of a smiley face, see the letter J, capital J. And I remember being puzzled over this for a long time. Certain people would send me emails, and there would be this funny J, like at the end of an email or something. I'd see something like this. And I finally like tracked it down. I don't remember if I figured it out myself or if I found somebody's explanation online or what, but I finally found out that, oh, it was this stupid autocorrect into this font that I don't have. And so I started noticing other cases where this sort of thing would happen. And not just J's, but occasionally other characters represented different, like a frowny face or different things. And then sooner or later, I started getting emails that ended with things like this. And okay, the call sign kind of made sense. Like, I knew that was a thing. But the 7-3, I thought for sure that that was some kind of emoticon gone awry. I'm not even kidding. I honestly thought this for a long time, because every now and then, I would get an email that would have 73 at the end instead of something like this. It was... So this leads me to a discussion of how amateur radio operators look to the outside world. What is that? How did that slide get there? I don't know why that slide's in this spot. It's an old white guy with a radio on his hip. So that's somewhat relevant. The amateur radio community, the way that it's viewed from the outside world, at least the way I saw it from as an outsider for many, many, many years, was as a group of operators. Remember earlier I was talking about operators versus experimenters. The identity of the amateur radio community, the way it was perceived by me, and the way I think most outsiders that I know perceive the amateur radio community, is my vision of an operator, someone who just uses the technology but doesn't advance the technology in any way. And it's a group that has a lot of jargon, maybe even more jargon than the hacker community, and that's saying something. 73 took me a long time to figure out. Elmer, I didn't figure out until Tom's talk last year. And wavelengths. I know a lot of amateurs find my puzzlement over this puzzling in themselves, I found it interesting that as I've learned more and more about radio and about communications, and I've worked with all sorts of different RF engineers and electronics engineers, and the only people that I ever talk to, pretty much, who routinely refer to different wavelengths are amateur radio operators. And it was confusing for me at first. It's a type of jargon within the amateur radio community that I don't even know that if most people recognize that is really so specific. But to me, it was, as an outsider, it was very confusing to hear somebody say something like the upper end of the 2 meter band. Well, what does upper mean? Think about that. That's a very confusing thing. So jargon is often hidden. You often don't realize it. And there are multiple different kinds of jargon. There's technical jargon, which is absolutely essential in any technical field. But there's also what you might call social jargon, which is, say, Elmer. There's no technical reason why you should use the word Elmer instead of another word like mentor. But it's a word that makes you feel part of the community. And maybe it has some nuance of meaning within the community, but mostly I would think that you'd use a lot of the social jargon just because it helps you feel part of the community. But unfortunately, there's a dark side in that the more jargon you use that makes you feel part of the community, the more jargon you're using that makes other people excluded from your community. And it becomes something confusing or frightening or just weird to people on the outside. When I was at the Boulder Labs, there was a story about the engineers had sent like an intern or some young engineer to go get his amateur radio license. And he like went down to the local club and took an exam and came back and said, "Oh my God, it's a cult." It's interesting how strong people's perceptions are. And you know, here's the deal. Here's to me, this is sort of the value proposition of amateur radio as the way it's been in the past. You study, you get your license, you follow the rules, and maybe you help out with some emergencies. You take on those responsibilities, and in return, you get to operate, and you get to be a part of the club. And operating is something that I think was really interesting to my uncle, but was never that interesting to me. And it was mentioned by somebody earlier that, maybe Bruce, somebody mentioned the internet didn't exist back then. Operating was so special, to be able to communicate with people around the globe, anywhere in the world potentially, with some effort, and being able to do it for free. Well, we say for free, but how much money did you spend today? So why bother? That was my perspective for a long time as I learned a little bit here and there about the amateur radio community. Why should I bother getting a license? Even long after I was getting into radio things and building my own radio devices and experimenting a lot, why should anyone bother actually joining this community, actually getting a license? And one additional reason that actually I did not get a license for some time. I actually avoided even thinking about getting a license because, well, you know, I like to do funky things and hack on things, and at some point, you know, maybe somebody might question what I'm doing, and I might actually be able to say, "Oh, I didn't know I was breaking any rules." You know, at this point, I think the plausible deniability ship has sailed for me. However, I do know plenty of people in the hacker community who have that point of view, who think, why would I bother taking on the liability of somebody being able to point to me, point to something that I did, point to an exam that I took, point to a license that I have, and say, you know better. And it's just a, it's not a major problem. It's not something that would that couldn't be overcome. But it's just one other little thing that leans people in the hacker community, I think, away from wanting to get their amateur radio license. But that's not to say that hackers don't want their amateur radio license. In fact, there are many, many people in the community, a growing number, I think, who are getting their license. And I think that the reason for that is because of the attitude towards experimentation. I sincerely believe that experimenters are the future of amateur radio. People in this room are experimenters, right? I mean, this is TAPR, this is AMSAT. These are people who are doing interesting things with technology. And for me, this was such an astonishing thing when I came to DCC the first time, that so much interesting work was being presented at the DCC. I was pleasantly surprised to find what I thought was fascinating technology being developed within the amateur radio community, and that there's a community within the community of experimenters. And it's not just operators. And operators are part of the community, and they're an important part, and culturally they're a very important part. But for me, as an outsider, my interest in community was greatly increased when I discovered all of you fine folks. And guess what? I think these folks make good experimenters, too. Hackers are almost by definition experimenters. Hacking is a word that is even used oftentimes to just talk about fiddling with something, tinkering with something, experimenting with something. That's what hacking is. And the hacker ideals, for the most part, I think fit fairly nicely with amateur radio ideals. Now, there are a couple things you might see on there that are a little bit out, like the questioning authority. But that's not to say that, hackers don't agree with the authority if there's a reason for it. And so I do think that in the long term, the fusing of these two cultures, of the amateur radio culture and the hacker culture, is really what's going to maintain the amateur radio community. When I go to amateur radio events, I often get a comment from people, somebody I've never met before, somebody who doesn't even know who I am, who just comes up to me and says, I'm so glad that you're here. It's great to have a young person here. And I want to look at them and say, do you have any idea how old I am? because when I go to a HackerCon, I'm one of the old guys. You know, the median age at a HackerCon is probably 15 years younger than me. And so I don't feel that I'm the next generation of the amateur radio community. I might be kind of bridging the gap. What the next generation is, I think maybe those hackers, or maybe the kids of those hackers. It may be the next generation of hackers who are discovering an opportunity to experiment with things. And last year at DEF CON, which is the biggest hacker con in the US, at least, there was an amateur radio exam with 205 candidates. 144 technician licenses were handed out to hackers. 22 general, 6 extra, and the youngest person to get a license that day was 13 years old. And actually, I didn't think of this just now, but I probably know him. Just look at those numbers and realize that this is where young people are getting into amateur radio. People are getting into amateur radio because they're coming from an environment that encourages experimentation, and they're saying, hey, I'd like to play with radio too. And I've often seen you know, over the last couple of years that I've been following, been looking at amateur radio work and events, and looking through the programs at Hamvention and DCC and so forth. And I've seen more and more places where people are doing interesting projects to advance amateur radio. And I think that's exciting work. But you might sometimes, if you find yourself thinking that you're trying to advance amateur radio, you might be setting the bar a little low. I encourage you to advance radio. And many of you are doing this. But I think many more could be doing this. That the amateur radio community shouldn't be limited by the term amateur. There's so much great stuff going on in this community. There are so many people who are experimenting with technologies that are truly cutting edge. And citizen science is becoming a greater and greater thing in our world. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the open access of scientific literature, but it's a major issue right now in the academic community that so much scientific literature gets published every year that is inaccessible to the general public without paying a fee. And this is, in my opinion, not science. If you're not publishing your work available in the widest, with the widest readership that you can have, if you're restricting the access to your work as a scientist, then in my opinion, you're not doing science. And it may be up to us, it may be up to the non-academic community to show the way. It may be up to the amateur radio community to show how to do science that is open to the world. And this is something that is very much a part of the hacker community. At information security conferences, there are very frequently new results, new things being published, new techniques that are developed independently or in groups by people that are not academics and are not getting published in journals, although sometimes there's crossover. There's a pretty significant crossover between the academic security community and the hacker community. But citizen science is an ingrained part of the hacker community, that anyone can advance anything. And for example, somebody who's developed an exploit for a vulnerability in a piece of software. Well, my friend and colleague, Dr. Sergey Bratis, who is one of those crossover people, a hacker in the academic community, as he says, an exploit is a proof by construction that a vulnerability exists. And anyone can publish that proof. And it is a valuable contribution to the knowledge of computer security. Well, same thing is true in amateur radio, where anyone can publish anything that is an advancement to radio technology. And I love the fact that I found this group within the amateur radio community, that so many people here tonight are people who truly do advance radio technology. And that that many of you are doing work that inspires experimenters, because I think that is the future of amateur radio, that if we do inspiring work to inspire the next generation of experimenters, I think that's how amateur radio is going to survive decades to come. Thank you. One more thing. Two more things. I use these throwing star land taps as business cards, and I have some of them up here. I'd love, if you want one, please come and get one. If I run out, get one at the TAPR booth tomorrow. And I also have an IME programmed with the spectrum analyzer. So if you want to play with it, have at it.
We'd like to thank Michael. I think that was a wonderful talk. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you had a wonderful evening. How was the meal today for everyone? All right, so now make sure that you have a designated driver to get you back to the hotel. Make sure you have some significant other tucking you in tonight. Get a good night's sleep so we can have a fantastic day tomorrow. And Barry?
Just a reminder, tomorrow at 11:15 a.m. is the AMSAT Forum in Forum Room 5. It runs from 11:15 to 1:30. Lots of good material being presented tomorrow about our next generation of projects and what's happening with the Fox program and our other activities. So please attend the forum tomorrow at 11:15. Thank you.
So there's one advantage of watching this here on Ham Radio Now. You don't have to find someone to drive you home. And I'm a big Michael Ossmann fan. I'm practically a groupie, even though he is an awesome engineer and an inventor, and I am an operator. And Michael, here in Ham Radio, we call them, lovingly, appliance operators. And I consider myself to be king of the appliance operator. Yes, I need deck over that. I am king of the appliance operators. Maybe that didn't need echo. There is room, and I think that there is a need for bumping the microphone. There is room, and I think a need for all of us. And we probably even need some young appliance operators. But we do need the explorers, the engineers, entrepreneurs. Need those folks too. Okay, don't forget the Kickstarter for doing the video for the TAPR DCC. The link is right here at hamradionow.tv. My thanks to Michael, to Thani, Steve, and Barry, everybody at TAPR and AMSAT for letting me use their material for a Ham Radio Now program. That is it for this episode. This guy down here is the bear. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, 73, over and out.